When it comes to common candidates, you are a common candidate. I think you're in three slates. Is it three or four slates? Do you believe there should be a limitation to this?
I don't know, Karen, because for example, your next guest is Governor Gwen, my fellow governor. All of the candidates have been flocking to her too, trying to get her on their good side, on her good side. I think most candidates will adopt common governors, common congressmen, common mayors in several parts of the country. The same is true with respect to senators, common senators. For me, it's not necessarily a bad thing. In fact, it perhaps can be something people can hold on to, because if opposing presidential candidates can agree, can come together with respect to some common candidates, well, perhaps there's room whomsoever will win in the next elections for them to also agree for the benefit of 110 million Filipinos.
Okay, but what happens to someone like yourself? You are with NPC, Senate President Tito Soto, who's your acting chairman, is running for vice president, and he clearly is with Senator Ping Lacson. Does that mean that you are for Senator Ping Lacson for president?
No, Karen, the NPC has not yet decided. Even with respect to Senate President Soto, there is no formal announcement as of yet. Usually the NPC, Karen, by tradition, decides sometime between February or March. And the decision can vary from endorsing a candidate to allowing each member to decide whom to endorse. That is what most NPC members are waiting for, Karen.
Okay, but it's a bit tricky for you as well, because Vice President Lenny Robredo, kumbaga, masasabi nating kaprobinsya mo, right? Pareho kayong Bicolano, so paano yun?
Do you feel... Hindi lang, Karen, yung kanyang maiden name na Herona ay Tigas Orsogon, Tigabulan ng Orsogon. Okay. In fact, she was welcomed very well by our province mates when she visited, and we hosted her visit to Orsogon. Ang tingin ko naman kasi, Karen, governor ka man, senador ka man, presidente ka man sa Davao, isang boto ka pa rin naman sa dulo. Ang bibilangin, boto pa rin ng bawat individual. Wala namang mas maraming boto yung governor o presidente o congressman o mayor. Dagdag pa siguro doon, bilang ama ng probinsya, nasa interes ng probinsya namin na makilala nila lahat ng tumatakbo para makapili ng husto. Hindi ko sasaraduhan, Karen, ng aming probinsya tulad ng ibang mga lugar na hindi pwede magpunta, pinapatayan ng kuryente, yung rally. Mas nais kong bukas ang aming lalawigan para makita at makilala lahat ng tumatakbo sa pagkapangulo, para sila rin ang makapili ng may nalalaman at may basehan.
Okay, so does this mean you will not be endorsing a presidential candidate, Governor Cheese?
I will wait until after the NPC decides, Karen, being a member of the NPC. Now, if they allow us to decide on our own, then we get to decide on our own. If they don't, if they choose someone which I am not personally comfortable with, then perhaps that's the decision of a party member to still remain with the party and not follow, or resign from the party if he does not agree with the decision of the party, which right now would be premature, Karen, because, again, no decision has yet been made by the party with respect to whom to support for president.
Okay. Now, what's interesting about your situation is, given that your father was former agricultural minister during Marcos's time, is you are also the principal author and sponsor of the law compensating martial law victims. So this is the Human Rights Victims Reparation and Recognition Act of 2013. Many people may not remember, or they tend to forget, that you are the principal author and sponsor of that landmark law. So given that this was your role in history, will you then welcome former Senator Bongbong Marcos, who is aspiring to be president? Where does that put you?
Karen, that law did not convict anyone. That law simply provided for the compensation of victims of torture and human rights violations during the time of former President Marcos. Monies recovered by the PCGG from their family. And if I might add, Karen, I was asked that question. So your dad was minister of former President Marcos. My immediate response was, you also have to remember, I ran against Bongbong in the last elections for vice president together with Vice President Lenny Robredo. My position would still be the same, Karen. And if he will come here, we will accept him. And I would want our people to meet him and see him and get to decide for themselves. It's not for me to prevent a candidate from visiting our province. That would be limiting our voters' wider knowledge, if at all, as to who they really want to vote for and support, regardless of affiliations.
Okay. When you ran against Bongbong in 2016, in an interview in Bandila, a late night newscast that we had in ABS-CBN, you said that Bongbong Marcos should first recognize and apologize for the human rights abuses during his father's time. You said this in 2016. And now he is running for president in 2022. And there's nothing close to this just yet.
If I remember what I said, Karen, if I'm not mistaken, ang ginamit ko at ang salita nun ay voluntary ang paghihingi ng sorry. At kung pinilit yan, hindi rin naman kapanipaniwala at hindi rin naman tatanggapin nung dapat bigyan ng sorry. At ang isang plato, pag nabasag na, kahit mag-sorry pa yung nakabasag, basag pa rin yung plato. Wala namang mababag, hindi naman mabubuo bigla yung platong yun. So para sa akin, it's up for Senator Marcos if he wants to apologize. Because if we force an apology out of him in any interview that you will be making with him, for example, it's also not going to be believable, much less acceptable to those asking for that apology. So unless it's voluntarily forthcoming, I don't think people will believe and accept it either. And I don't think he has any plans of doing so, given his past interviews and past positions.
Okay. And do you believe he's still short?
I'm sorry?
Do you believe he's still short? He is running for the highest position of the land. What are the implications of a non-recognition of the past?
Again, Karen, whether he should say sorry or not is up to him. Because if he does not, then let the voters use that as basis whether or not they will vote for him or not. But if you force an apology from a person who doesn't want to, again, it's not believable as well, nor is it acceptable. So it should come from him and it should be his decision whether or not he will do it. It's not up for us or me to force it from his mouth if he's not willing to do so.
Okay. Well, politics is all about addition. Given that you are the principal author and sponsor of this particular law, hypothetically, if you are asked to be in Bongbong Marcos's slate, you're added into the Senate slate, you're adopted as a common candidate. Where does that put Governor Chiz Escudero? Will you accept that, given you were the principal author and sponsor of the human rights law? I mean, the reparation.
I know where you're leading to, Karen. I've worked with Senator Marcos. I've worked with people who I don't agree with 100% of the time on all issues. But that does not necessarily make it unlivable for me to be with them or to work with them as well on other issues that we agree on. He cannot change my mind with respect to certain things, and I may not be able to change his mind with respect to certain things. But that does not take away the possibility of if he should win, for example, when he was in the Senate. Karen, when the law was passed, Senator Marcos was in the Senate. And he, I think, abstained during the voting. So that does not detract from me working with anyone simply because I disagree with them on one, two, or on many points. So it would be presumptuous of me to answer the question because I have no idea if he will. I think they will be announcing, according to his camp, after November 15, given the various changes that may still happen. But you're correct, Karen. Kahit anong tulong, sino ba naman ako para magsabi? Let's say a BBM supporter would say, I'm voting for you. Sasabihin mo, Karen, hindi, ayoko yung sinusuporta mong presidente. You would say thank you. And it's not for you to say no to anyone who offers help. But to my mind, Karen, it does not necessarily mean that I have to change any position I will be making. Now, if that is a condition precedent before an adoption would be made, then that's a totally different story.
Okay. And do you believe, Governor, this particular stand is why you have some sectors who mistake you for being a traditional politician, one who adjusts or flexes with the wind, so to speak?
Karen, I think I've taken my positions quite clearly, depending on the situation at hand. not depending on the political winds, but depending on the issue. Again, a traditional politician is one who decides based on his own personal interests. I have not shown that in the past. In fact, I've chosen the more difficult path many times over in the past, simply because that is what I believed in. Now, some people may disagree with that, but that was what I believed in at that particular point in time, which I thought was right. I may have been wrong, I may have been proven right, but at the end of the day, let history be the judge of that. I was asked the same question when Vice President Robredo adopted me. They used as a basis, for example, when then Senator Kiko was simply noting our objections in the FPJ elections. Same banana, Karen. We disagreed on that point, but that does not make us enemies. That does not detract from the fact that we can work on other things together that we perhaps agree on, and simply disagree on certain other things. Hindi kami mag-asawa, Karen, na lahat ng bagay kailangan namin pag-agrihan. Kahit ngayon mag-asawa, nag-aaway at hindi nag-agree sa lahat ng bagay. Ano pa kaya kami na hindi nakatira sa iisang bahay?
Okay, now let's talk about the tax issues that are being faced by the former senator, and because you are an expert on matters of law, Section 12 of the Omnibus Election Code states that a person shall perpetually be disqualified or disqualified from running for public office if he's been sentenced by final judgment for certain things. And that part of the Omnibus Election Code describes, well, you'd have to be, of course, sentenced to a penalty of more than 18 months. It involves moral turpitude. So I want to ask you, because this is discussed now, would you consider failure to file an ITR for a public official a crime that actually is covered by moral turpitude?
I'm not aware of any Supreme Court decision, Karen, that actually includes failure to file income tax return as moral turpitude. I've seen several decisions that
enumerate. There was, Governor, 2009, actually penned by then Justice Diosdado Peralta, declared that failure to file an income tax return, is not a crime. Is not a crime for moral turpitude.
I have yet to see one, so that means it is ripe for something to be decided upon by the Supreme Court, should someone assert that it is. But having said that, Karen, there is a process that should be followed with respect to this. I don't know what they filed. I haven't read any of the petitions. If it's a petition for disqualification, for example, based on that belief that it's moral turpitude, or is it a petition for disqualification based on a material misrepresentation in the COC file? That a question is asked in the COC, Karen. All of us had to answer that. If you have been convicted of a crime involving moral turpitude, and all of us answered no, I guess. So there may be two bases to file a disqualification case. I've yet to see any of the petitions. So depending on the technique or the tact they intend to pursue, that's what the COMELEC will decide upon too. I just hope, Karen, that should it be brought up to the Supreme Court by the aggrieved party, whomsoever will lose, I hope that the Supreme Court will decide on it with dispatch. Because the last thing you want is a sword of Damocles hanging over your head, so to speak, where people don't know if you will be disqualified or not, so they will withhold support and wait for the outcome. Very much, for example, what happened with FPJ before, if you remember. It took some time before the decision was handed down. And of course, COMELEC has to decide too during the pendency of the case, will they put your name in the ballot? Because the ballots need to be printed, Karen, by December for it to be rolled out and distributed to every precinct in the country. So these are things that need to be decided upon, not only by the Supreme Court, but also by the COMELEC, in order to avoid confusion during election time.
Okay, but then do you believe, Governor, that given that there's already a 2009 decision by then Justice Diosdado Peralta, and just to clarify, because it's in my notes, it's not a crime, is it still has to be taken to the Supreme Court?
It can still, Karen. Usually people bring forth to the Supreme Court similar questions in the hope of reversing an earlier decision, especially if it was a divided court. Especially, again, I'm not aware of that decision, Karen, if only a division rendered that decision. But even if the en banc Supreme Court rendered that decision, if it was a divided court, let's say a split vote, 8-7, then there's room to bring the question back to the Supreme Court again in the hope that they will give it a second look and decide either in the same way or differently.
Mm-mm. What do you, I mean, given that your father did serve as agriculture minister during the Marcos time, what does a possible return of the Marcos for the presidency mean to the country?
Quite frankly, Karen, I haven't gone that far thinking about it. I think that's the main reason, though, why Senator Marcos is receiving not really majority, but a lot of support. Mm-mm. Because people want something different. Now, that's something that's different may not be even definable. Because, Karen, for me, he may be the same as his father. He may be different, too. I'm sure he has learned the lessons from history and from reading history and living through it. And I'm of the firm belief that learning from the past and learning from history can only make you a better, wiser person. Mm-mm. Quite frankly, I haven't gone as far as thinking about it. Like yung batas bang pinasa, papabaliktad ba, papalitan ba yung pangalan ng airport. I have no idea.
Or what's taught in history even?
Or what's taught in history even. It has gone through a process. It goes through a process. It usually takes 4 to 5 years, Karen, to change the contents of any book, much less change the curriculum of either primary or secondary schools. So it's not going to be that fast too. But it would be nice to see. It would be nice to see how he will define his being a unifying president, according to his declaration speech. Because clearly, reversing some things, changing some things, might not be as unifying as it may appear to be right now.
Okay. Now, my last question is, it's a whole other show when we discuss how you want to strengthen the LGUs. That takes a whole other show, and we can do that another time. But very quickly, just to go, what would you consider as the biggest achievement of the Duterte administration and its biggest failure?
The Build program, Karen, which has helped our province a lot and a lot of provinces as well, and the rolling out of these various infrastructure projects, especially during the pandemic, because it provided a lot of jobs. Its biggest failure would be, for me, the inability to communicate properly what they really mean. Hence, a lot of misunderstandings, not only domestically, but also from the international community. That has led to so many wasted time simply answering and addressing those issues, which could have all been avoided had the president not been as forthright and as frank as he normally is when he's being interviewed or is facing the camera.
What about the possibility of the president possibly running for the Senate and he might end up being your colleague? Do you think it's wise that he does that?
A unique situation, but I've seen it also happen. If you remember, former President Gloria Macapagal Arroyo, after she finished her term, ran for Congress and was an ordinary congressman until she became Speaker later on in that term. So that will not be the first time it will happen, if at all.
Mm-mm. All right. On that note, Governor Chiz Escudero, thank you so much. Is there anything you want to add, Governor, before we go?
Siguro sa parte ng mga LGU, nais ko din tutukan, Karen, dahil yung naging karanasan ko bilang gobernador, malaking pagbubukas ng mata at kaisipan kaugnay sa mga dapat ibigay sa ating mga LGU, kabilang ng mas malawak at malayang kapangyarihan at desisyon na magpasya para sa aming mga lugar. We know better by far compared to any secretary sitting in their comfortable offices in NCR what we need and what needs to be done. And if given the opportunity, I will be able to provide that right and that power to LGUs. One brief example, Karen, yung budget namin sa LGU dumadaan sa DDM. Kailangan nilang aprubahan bawat item ng budget namin. Samantalang pera naman ng LGU yun. Hindi naman pera galing sa national government yun, karapatan ng LGU yun. Pero kailangan pa rin i-aprubahan nila yung bawat item na pinapasa namin sa aming sariling appropriation ordinance.
But do you need a law for that, or doesn't the Mandanas ruling actually give LGUs not just more money but more freedom?
That's not true, Karen. The Mandanas ruling simply says that we should get a share with respect to internal revenue taxes collected by the Bureau of Customs, and that these taxes should be automatically released to us. But yeah. The Supreme Court decision did not make it retroactive. It made it start in 2019 only. So Karen, we will be receiving a bigger era in 2022. But come 2023, since it's based on 2020 internal revenue of the national government, it will all of a sudden go spiraling down by about at least 18 to 23%. So I think LGU should be circumspect with respect to spending the windfall they will be receiving from Andanas next year, because by the following year, they might find it that they are short if they don't spend it on non-recurring expenditures and spend it instead on recurring expenditures.
Mm-hmm. So Governor, last question, you actually need a law to remove the DBM actually having to go through that process of itemizing everything, or now the LGU spends the money?
Or that is required by regulation, Karen. We need a law to specifically prohibit it and not allow it. The law does not provide for that. By regulation, by tradition, by practice, DBM has been implementing that. There should be a law prohibiting specifically that particular review of the DBM and by the DBM.
All right. Governor Cheese Escudero, thank you so much for joining me this morning. We can talk about other issues soon. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Karen. Good morning.